Hello, everyone. Thank you for tuning in to another episode of Song and Beyond on idagio.com in cooperation with the Hampson Foundation. My name is Steve Rodgers. I am a music theory professor at the University of Oregon, and I'm delighted to be guest hosting Song and Beyond for the month of April. I've been bringing in some guests who focus on women and song, and today I'm delighted to get a chance to talk to Carol Oja from Harvard University and Mark Burford from Reed College. Thank you so much for joining me.
It's a pleasure.
I thought that you would be ideal guests for this program because both of you in one way or another focus on two of the most important singers in the 20th century, and they are the Black American women, Marian Anderson, the classical contralto, and Mahalia Jackson, the gospel singer. And studying them, I think, gives us a window into how they were performing in the 20th century, how they were reckoning with the obstacles that they faced, and what their singing means to us today. I thought we might start with Marian Anderson, the earliest of the two singers. And Carol, maybe I'll start with a question for you. Some people watching this may have heard her name. Some people may not know that much about her. Can you just tell us who she was and why she's an important figure in the 20th century?
Of course, yes. Marian Anderson was born in 1897 in Philadelphia. And in the course of her career, which spanned many decades, she managed to breakthrough into the world of concert recital performance, classical music performance, in a way that was difficult for just about any American. It was largely a European dominated field, but was virtually impossible for someone who was African American. And there are a number of landmark dates in her career, which sort of give a sense of where she was positioned in relation to the institutions around her and sort of her moment in time. One of them is 1925, when she's still in her 20s. She won a major contest in New York City that was sponsored by the National Music League and the New York Philharmonic. The New York Philharmonic in its summer iteration, which was the Stadium Orchestra, which performed at Lewison Stadium at City College. So she won improbably, was one of four winners of this contest, which meant attaining a performance with the Philharmonic Orchestra at Lewison Stadium that summer, a very big deal, unprecedented in the history of the New York Philharmonic to feature a performer of color in front of the orchestra, and opened the door for other Black performers within that context. That is the Philharmonic with the stadium concerts, not the Philharmonic in Carnegie Hall, but within the context of these summertime outdoor concerts for other performers of color to be featured. So that's 1925. Then probably the most famous moment in her life came on Easter Sunday in 1939 when she performed at the Lincoln Memorial. She had been refused access to Constitution Hall, which was owned by the Daughters of the American Revolution. The Secretary of the Interior stepped in, offered her this outdoor space, which has since become a place for civil rights gatherings. I mean, the March on Washington, the I Have a Dream speech happened from that same spot where she performed on that Sunday afternoon in 1939. But it was a major political event, a major artistic event, and sort of defined her for really the rest of her career. And the final moment in terms of her major triumphs that I'll mention is 1955, when she debuted with the Metropolitan Opera, opera company that was then 75 years old, had never featured a performer of color in a leading role, had in fact, until the early 50s, it's not unfair to say it had been a Jim Crow institution. It had been fairly committed to whites-only practices. So Anderson sailed through these moments, which looking back could seem like, wow, it just happened, but obviously it didn't. It took incredible personal resolve, talent, studying over the course of years, the capacity to align people around her to support her and sort of make these events possible. And so for many reasons, she stands out.
Carol, a follow-up question to that. So clearly she faced many obstacles and overcame them, but not without difficulty and not without the help of other people. You are working on a book about racial desegregation in classical music, which doesn't focus exclusively on Marian Anderson, but discusses her. Could you talk about how, what her role was in the civil rights movement in helping others to overcome their own obstacles? Did she play a role in the larger movement once she had some position of stature?
She did, very definitely. She did not do so in ways that are conventional seeming in terms of racial protest. She did not issue major statements against racism. she was not part of protests. She basically kind of kept her attitudes about race largely, not completely, to herself. Mm. What she did do is she put herself, I mean, literally her body, in these positions that were dangerous often, and that certainly were bucking against the tide all around her, against the restrictions that were holding her and other performers down. And she sang. She showed up and she performed at her best capacity. Her level of professionalism was unfailing. And somehow that dignity and that discipline were sort of her tools of racial protest.
So sort of protesting by being there, by being physically present, by being visible. Am I right too? And Mark, I want to pivot to you on this because you both wrote lovely essays for the Women's Song Forum, and you're both a part of that team. And Mark, in fact, I think yours was the very first essay on the Women's Song Forum. You were our leadoff hitter. And one thing that you have discussed and what you write about in your essay is her relationship with composers in Europe and some of the repertoire that she performed by European composers. Am I right that, so she faced many restrictions in the States, but at least before the Second World War, she found a little more success and freedom in Europe. Is that true, Mark? And maybe you could tell us a little bit about her connection with a particular European composer, Sibelius, someone whom she befriended and whose music she sang.
That's right. And I think to build upon Carol's point about the political significance of just singing, because I think for a lot of Black classical artists, the mere fact of them singing against all the odds is itself significant. So I think Europe was important for Anderson, as it is for all perhaps American classical artists, in terms of training that you might get in Europe, in terms of prestige you might get in Europe, but particularly for African-American artists, I think for the opportunities you would get in Europe that you might not get in the United States. So for instance, Anderson, prior to really going to Europe, and she spent several years there in the 1930s, was largely relegated to singing for African-American audiences in the United States. Obviously the Lewiston Stadium was performance was a big opportunity, but part of the reason why she went to Europe is that a lot of her concert season was spent kind of on very rugged tours of the South, being supported by Black churches and Black, historically Black colleges and universities. And that's actually significant because I think her career would not have been possible without this infrastructure from Black communities. I think that, I mean, it's right now is a really interesting moment in African-American music scholarship, because I think a lot of scholars are thinking about this very complex multi-sided relationship between African-Americans and classical music. And I think one of the stories for Anderson was the ways in which her community in Philadelphia, which is a big Black classical music town, was really a support system for her. But Europe was really important as well too. And I think she was able to make direct connections with composers, one of them being Sibelius through her accompanist, Kosti Vahanen, who is also Finnish, like Sibelius. And she actually went to Sibelius's home to study. She had been practicing songs with Vahanen, but then went to Sibelius's home to basically workshop some of this repertory with her, and was very active. It was striking to me that she recorded so much of Sibelius's music in the late 30s. I think she maybe recorded 10 of his songs at a time when his music was not necessarily part of American recitalist repertory, and her commitment to singing them in Swedish, the language most of his songs were in, indicate a real commitment. And she talks about the work of being a classical artist being significant, but the work for a Black classical artist being even more so. So to take on that task on top of all of the other challenges she faced and just the sheer labor it takes to be a concert artist is pretty remarkable.
What kind of, this is a question for both of you, what kind of repertoire did she gravitate towards? So she, I know that she, I believe she grew up singing in the church as so many Black performers did. And, you know, she's performed spirituals, but she also performed Schubert and Donizetti and Sibelius and a number of pieces by European composers. Maybe Carol, I'll ask you this, because I know you've written about her performance of Donizetti in particular. What repertoire was her kind of her wheelhouse repertoire, the music that she was really drawn to, that she performed most often, and that she's particularly well known for singing?
Well, she's probably best known for her performances of African-American spirituals in concert arrangements, piano vocal arrangements, with which she conventionally, regularly concluded concerts. So that was, in terms of perceptions of her from the outer world, that was what she was most marked with. But equally as important were other repertories, especially the Austro-German Lieder tradition of the 19th century. She was especially known for her performances of Schubert. Schubert Ave Maria was among her standards in many ways, as were other Schubert songs. And she often faced questions, especially early in her career, about how legitimate it was for an African-American woman to be performing songs in other languages, especially mm-hmm. German, you know, this language that has such cultural authority in the world of classical music. And as with so many things, she sort of met that challenge head on. I mean, one of her reasons for going to Europe was to study languages, to become just more fluent in European culture overall, which then would carry into her artistry. So there's those two aspects, the sort of Austro-German art songs, the spirituals, and then finally isolated opera arias, which she did perform with some regularity, oddly in some ways, since she and other African-American singers of her day were banned essentially from the stages of American opera houses. And it was an issue in international opera houses too. Yet she stuck with the repertory and continued to program it through her outer career.
One thing that stands out to me, I think it's worth remembering, this is back to your point about just being present, being a body singing this repertoire, a wide variety of repertoire. This is, of course, a time when Black people in the United States, you know, they spoke English, but I think the perception, sadly, among some was that they perhaps didn't speak English properly or appropriately enough. And already there's that obstacle to overcome. And she's not only, of course, singing in English, but singing in other languages. And that's a fearsome thing to do. I wonder if, Carol, you sent me a few songs, performances of hers. One is Deep River, one is the Donizetti aria that became one of her staples, and then a recording of Schubert's Erl King. I would love to listen to a performance. Do you have a preference for one of those that we might listen to?
Let's listen to A Deep River. It's okay. Harry Burley's arrangement. Burley was an African-American composer, pianist, and baritone who was a generation older than Anderson. This was one of her staples. It's a beautiful, resonant performance, characteristic of how she would approach the songs, which were essentially folk repertory, as though they were written by Schubert, with the same sort of attitude and regal bearing in many ways that she brought to German art song.
And before we listen to Deep River, I'd like to ask both of you just to kind of have some ideas in our mind. What is it that you find most remarkable about her voice? We'll get to hear it in a moment, but if you had to use a few words to describe what makes it one of the singular voices of the 20th century, what would you say? Mark, maybe I'll start with you.
Yeah, I would. I mean, one of the things that was that I'm working on the liner notes for a box set of Marian Anderson's recordings should be out soon. And one of the things listening to that body of work, her recordings prior to the Easter Sunday, 1939 Easter Sunday concert, and listening to them in their entirety, the range of her voice is just remarkable. I mean, because she's so associated with spirituals, the kind of darker hues of her voice are often emphasized, and you hear that at the beginning of Deep River. But the upper part of her voice was gorgeous as well too. And you hear that kind of huge octave leap that we get earlier in the tune that kind of showcases that. The other thing I'll say, just following up on something Carol said a moment ago too, is Anderson's career, I think, also helps us kind of think more critically about what that means, the music in the Black church. Because it's not like she was just singing spirituals in the church and then singing concert repertory on the stage. There were performances of Handel's Messiah in her church. There were performances of Rossini's Stabat Mater in the church. So in some ways, though her repertory expanded, spirituals and classical repertory are side by side. So the kind of classicized rendering of Deep River is emblematic of something broader about the co-presence of different repertories in the Black
church.
That's
fascinating. Carol, I'll get to you in a second, but so in the 1939 concert, I believe she did Schubert's Ave Maria, right? And also, and ended with some spirituals. So there's Schubert side by side with spirituals. And it's interesting, I wasn't aware that, so that's a more kind of public, massive space for a very large audience. And then in somewhat smaller settings in the church, she's bringing classical repertoire and mingling it with spiritual. So that kind of mingling happened in many different spaces. I mean, that itself is a very brave act for her to have done. Carol, what would you say if you know her voice so well, you know her performance as well, what words would you use to describe her voice? What makes it so one of a kind?
Well, as Mark just pointed out, I mean, her range was exceptional, and her capacity to control that range was really something. One thing that people listening to Anderson, when they heard her perform on stage, would often mention is just the emotional intensity of her performances and the degree to which she, I mean, her charisma, her capacity to connect with an audience. So, I mean, that's sort of expands the notion of what a voice is, but it's part of this whole dynamic of both the instrument itself and then the way in which it's used and the way in which others perceive it. But emotionally, she had a lot to deliver.
Well, let's listen to Deep River.
Hold me.
When is that recording from, Carol? Do you know exactly?
I don't. It's from the early 1950s. Mark might know the exact date.
Yeah, not sure. It might even be earlier than that, but yeah, I'm not sure.
What strikes me, just hearing your comments about her voice, there's a darkness and a depth to it, but also such flexibility. And you're absolutely right, Mark, when she goes up to high notes, they're just floating high notes. The ability to navigate those, not just different registers, but different kind of timbres, different vocal colors, it's really extraordinary.
Yeah, her range was, I mean, demonstrably 3 octaves. Some people claim that, but on the recordings, you can hear the range. And also, especially with the spirituals, but also with the arias, she recorded them multiple times. So it's actually interesting to hear her, the way she kind of grows in her interpretation of a song over the period of decades sometimes.
Sorry, go ahead, Carol. You're going
to
say.
Actually, I have a question for Mark related to what he just said. I have a friend who's a singer who has wondered whether Anderson, with that incredible range and those beautiful high notes, was labeled as a contralto early on for racial reasons. Hmm. If sort of that black sounding, to in a way kind of stereotype it, mm-hmm. part of her voice, is what she was most characterized by. And I wonder what you think about that.
I think it's absolutely true that Black women singers were often labeled as contralto. Mahalia Jackson was too when she first started, interestingly. But I definitely think that the contralto voice had certain kind of character associations in opera, but also I think racial associations within the opera world and the concert world. On the other hand, Anderson identified very strongly as a contralto. In fact, she resisted. She was constantly being pushed. You got to sing Aida. You got to sing Aida. And she says, "No, I'm not a soprano. I'm a contralto." So she identified very strongly. So it's interesting to think about her voice alongside other contralto voices of the 30s and 40s as a point of comparison. But she was very much convinced in her mind that she was a contralto and wanted to kind of sing repertory or a mezzo, and wanted to sing the repertory that featured her range and her voice in that range.
She had a very long life. She lived until 1993, is that correct? When did she stop singing? I've seen interviews with her, and she's clearly old and talking about her career, but at what point did she stop singing? How long did her career last, considering that her life was very long?
Well, she sang into the 1970s, and sometimes to the dismay of her critics, because the flexibility of her voice, sometimes the intonation slipped as she aged, but she continued to sing and perform. And I mean, the woman seems to have been something of a workaholic. I mean, she worked a lot. She traveled a lot. She gave a lot of concerts. This was her entire life. And so I think stopping was probably a real challenge.
Mm-hmm. I thought maybe we could listen to one more excerpt. So Mark, you were saying that you're both saying that she paired different repertoires in a way that was really novel. I thought maybe we could listen to the beginning of Schubert's Erl King. And I'd say this is a recording of hers that I had not heard. This is one of the most famous German songs of the 19th century, recorded by many people. Maybe we can just listen to a bit of it so that we can have a comparison in repertoire, but also hear how she uses the same kind of vocal colors, the similar techniques in spirituals and also in Schubert. So I'll just play a clip of the Schubert so we can hear something by way of contrast. So here's the beginning of Schubert's Erl King.
Du Schnachtelbild,
there we hear the vocal quality is similar, but she's in a higher register, I was surprised when I listened to this because it sounded much higher than I expected she would be singing. And that speaks to your point, Mark, that her range was really incredible, and her ability to control her vocal timbre in all of those different ranges was equally incredible.
And that song is interesting too, just because with the multiple characters, when she's because she has that ability to kind of really mobilize her voice, the colors and the timbral inflections of her voice, as the song shifts from character to character, she's able to kind of use that as an expressive device.
One thing I'd add here is the accompanist is a German named Franz Rupp, who mm-hmm. became her accompanist in the late 30s and stayed with her for the rest of her career. And one of the challenges that she took on was to appear on stage as a Black woman with a white male accompanist, mm-hmm. to hold hands with that person as they bowed. And often performing in the South, she would be criticized for that. Or there were incidents where Rupp was asked behind the scenes before a concert to avoid touching her when they accepted applause at the end, and he would refuse to do that. I mean, they held hands and they bowed. But you could hear he's quite a player, and he's part of the drama that gets excited by that performance.
Absolutely. One final question about Marian Anderson before we pivot to Mahalia Jackson. It strikes me that, so we might think that, wow, what she was suffering from in the middle of the 20th century, those are things of the past. She's a historical figure. She may be even be a figure that some people are not aware of today or have forgotten. And yet, of course, the challenges that Black singers face continue. I mean, just the fact that, for example, I think it wasn't until 2015 that the Metropolitan Opera did Othello without blackface, right? Which is shocking. And I'm wondering if each of you could comment on what Marian Anderson's legacy means to us today. What can we learn from her? What singers, and I have some in my own mind, were influenced by her who are continuing to put their bodies out there and sing repertoire in spaces that are not always safe for them? What does she mean to us today? It's a big question, I realize, but I'd love to hear your thoughts on it.
I would just say really briefly that, it's a cliche that, you need to see it to be it, but just the image of seeing Marian Anderson, and even if it's kind of iterative through her iconography kind of circulating, I think for Black classical artists. And I think it's also just, how much additional labor it takes for Black classical artists to be seen and heard. And I think it's just a reminder of that. The fact that it took until 1955, when she was in her late 50s, to even get on the Met stage, even though she was one of the most famous vocalists in the world, is remarkable. So I think that the additional labor of being, of classical singing while Black, I think is worth registering in her career.
What would you say, Carol?
Well, I echo all that. And I mean, the two words that occur to me are courage and integrity, mm-hmm. Which she exhibited time and again. I mean, both a personal and professional level. I mean, she had the courage to continue performing despite odds that were more often than not stacked against her. And she had a lot of personal integrity. There was a moral dignity to her that conveyed itself fully to audiences time and time again. And somehow retaining that dignity, that sense of a moral core in today's world, when there's so many ways it can be shaken up and challenged, is it's important to remember about her and to value.
Well, thank you for your thoughts on her. We'll have a little time to chat about her perhaps at the end, but I'd like to pivot from one major singer in the 20th century to another, and that is Mahalia Jackson. And it's worth pointing out here that, so Mahalia Jackson is a gospel singer, but there are many interesting overlaps. They both grew up in the church. They both performed in front of the Lincoln Memorial in very iconic performances in 1939 for Marian Anderson and 1963 for Mahalia Jackson. So there's a parallel there. Just one quick question before we talk in detail about Mahalia Jackson. Did they know each other? Did they move in the same circles? Or I think I've read that Mahalia Jackson claims to have been influenced by Marian Anderson's singing, but did they know one another?
That's a really good question. I don't know if they ever met, but you know, it's interesting because Marian Anderson was a constant point of reference for Mahalia Jackson, particularly in her early career. I mean, most often talked about is how Mahalia Jackson listened to Bessie Smith records and learned how to sing, and she claimed that that was a major influence. But she talked that she was also listening to Marian Anderson records. And I think that their points of contact are one in terms of vocal technique, that she thought about what kind of triangulating the voices of her voice with Bessie Smith and Marian Anderson, which I think is really interesting. I think also the prestige of the concert artist, that when Mahalia Jackson was coming of age, the fact that they were calling her a contralto, and she was often compared to Marian Anderson in newspapers, because I don't think there was another point of comparison. You know, a Black woman's voice, Marian Anderson was the voice to compare it to, until gospel itself kind of comes to the fore a little bit more in the 30s. But it's interesting also, as Jackson got more attention, Anderson was compared with her almost at Anderson's expense. So a lot of people whereas in the 30s and 40s, people might have said, you know, Marian Anderson was the ultimate Black woman's voice. In the 50s, in late 40s and 50s, you hear people writing that, well, even though Marian Anderson is so great, if you want to hear a real Black woman's voice, you got to hear Mahalia Jackson. So there's that both prestige and racial fantasy that was associated in comparing the two voices. So it's interesting to see that shift from Mahalia Jackson is as powerful as Marian Anderson to Marian Anderson isn't as racially expressive as Mahalia Jackson. So it's an interesting relationship to—
answered the question, my follow-up question, which is, why do you think that happened? What accounts for that shift in perception about Marian Anderson in relation to Mahalia Jackson?
It's a really good question. I mean, I think that part of it is the reception of classical music itself, vis-a-vis Black vernacular expression. And I think that what happens a lot is that for a lot of white audiences who got to know Mahalia Jackson in the late 40s, and particularly in the 50s, Black vernacular music, particularly gospel music, was not heard very often. So I think there was a novelty of the music being heard in popular culture. I think there is always a preference for certain kinds of Black voices and certain kinds of Blackness, that seeing Marian Anderson sing Schubert offers a different kind of pleasure than seeing this New Orleans gospel singer, tear it up in a church or on a concert stage singing gospel songs. So I think it's the reception of Jackson and Anderson is as much about us as it is about their voices.
That's a really important point. Before we get too far ahead of ourselves, Mark, I want to ask you the same question I asked Carol. Some people, I think most people will know who Mahalia Jackson was, but in case they don't, can you just give a kind of thumbnail sketch? Like, who was she? Where did she grow up? What kind of music is she best known for singing? And why is she such an important singer in the 20th century?
I think I'd take those questions in reverse order. I mean, the importance as a singer, she has been, her life and career has been commemorated repeatedly in popular culture. So there's a biopic that just came out about Mahalia Jackson on the Lifetime Channel, but there's two other biopics in production right now. There have been 7 staged musicals based on her life, which is pretty remarkable. So there's a kind of ritual retelling of her life and career. And I think the reason for that is precisely her life story and the way it's in some ways a kind of quintessential African-American story. She was the grandchild of emancipated slaves who migrated from central Louisiana to New Orleans. She was born in New Orleans. She subsequently migrates from New Orleans to Chicago, where she gets involved, arrives right when the gospel movement is kind of kicking in the gear in the early 30s. And she was also very involved with the civil rights movement, was very much, even before it became a national issue, she was involved in political campaigns in Chicago, became good friends with Martin Luther King. So in some ways, I think her story as someone who kind of brings gospel music into the mainstream, so to speak, is kind of paralleled by this kind of story of migration from the rural South to the urban South to the urban North. So I think the telling of her story, I think, allows us to kind of think about really important narrative threads within American history and African American history.
Mm-hmm. I'd love to listen to her singing. Maybe we can start with that and then kind of go on from there. And Mark, you sent me a few things, and I think it's worth pointing out that she is best known for singing gospel music, and in fact, and maybe we can talk about this for a moment, was not interested largely in singing other kinds of repertoire, blues, for example, even though she was so popular and people thought that she could be even more marketable if she was doing that. Could you talk about that for a moment, maybe before we listen to one of these gospel pieces, what repertoire she was committed to singing and less committed to singing?
Yeah, it's actually a more complicated question than you'd think, because I think early in her career, she's very much rooted in the Black gospel community, which means that she was very much connected with Black gospel composers. So living people who are writing gospel songs. I think a lot of time Black church music is depicted as being anonymous in some ways, that it just kind of springs from the earth, or that just grew up singing in the church, that everybody is everybody's just singing this common stock repertoire. But there was a group of composers and songwriters who she was very connected with. So she sang a lot of recent songs as well too. I think when she switches over to a major label, there's more compromise, I think, than she would be willing to recognize. She sang at the Newport Jazz Festival. She sang, Beatles covers, critics would say that whatever she sang, she made it sound like it was Black vernacular music. Yeah. So you kind of almost forgot its source. So, but she was constantly, I think, negotiating how her label wanted to, what kind of repertory Columbia wanted her to sing that might enable her to cross over. And kind of staying true to her gospel repertoire. But I do think there was a shift from, she did fewer kind of strict gospel songs later in her career as an album artist than she did earlier in her career as an Apollo recording artist.
Well, maybe we can, you sent me three different gospel recordings. Which would you like to listen to? You sent Jesus Is With Me, Closer With Me, and He's Pleading in Glory for Me. Which would be a good one to dive into?
Maybe Closer would be a good one to listen to, in part because my next Women's Song Forum post is about Doris Akers, who is an African-American gospel songwriter, who is a crossover person herself, who worked with both Black and white churches, and thus she kind of falls between the cracks within gospel history. But this is a song by her that I think that Jackson really enjoyed singing Akers' songs. And this would have been a brand new song. So this would have been a hot off the presses, not even on the presses yet. This was before it was even published, gospel song and more of a gospel ballad.
And when is this recording from, roughly?
I think the recording is around kind of fall 1950, I think is when it was recorded. And then the song wasn't published until 55. So it was, as very typical, the songs kind of circulated before they actually appeared as sheet music.
Well, here is Mahalia Jackson singing Closer to Me. Thank you. Wow, extraordinary. Can I ask you the same question I asked about Marian Anderson before we listened to her performance? What is it about this voice? I mean, it's so clear that it's, what's one thing that strikes me is it's a very different voice from Marian Anderson, but the level of control that she sings with, and also with such force is really remarkable. Maybe Carol, I'll ask you, what is it about this voice that you think has made it one of the most important voices of the 20th century?
The main point, just it seems to me, has to do with virtuosity and a kind of discipline with the voice, a capacity to control it, to be expressive with it, to move all over with the place with it. I mean, there can be times when you're listening to a performer and you worry about what's going to happen with the next note. And with Mahalia Jackson, you never have that fear. You just know it's solidly placed and she's got it.
Yeah, absolutely. Mark, what would you say?
I think this example is really interesting just because of the meeting of songwriter and song, you know. So Doris Akers, you can see, and she had a period of her career where she was writing popular songs and this kind of AABA structure, which you don't necessarily get in a gospel song, allows kind of expressive opportunities for Jackson, where she really kind of amps up the intensity during the bridge. And kind of starts from, so if Anderson is using the kind of registers of her voice explicitly, this kind of intensity, this kind of fire hose on full blast part of her voice, and this kind of very tender handling of this kind of the filigree in the earlier part of the song, I think is really extraordinary. So the kind of theatrical kind of arc of the song that she masters, I think, is really impressive.
And yet, Carol used the word discipline. I mean, she does that with such discipline, with such control, despite the fact that she's able to shift the intensity of her voice throughout the song. One thing I want to make sure that we discuss, so we talked about Marian Anderson's role within the civil rights movement, and you were both saying that she was not loudly protesting out in the streets necessarily, but she was engaging in a form of protest by being there, by singing, by putting her body in places that were sometimes unsafe, by singing different repertoire that people were not accustomed to hearing Black women sing, Black women or men sing, or thought that they shouldn't be singing. Could you talk about Mahalia Jackson's comparable, but I think different role in the civil rights movement? You were saying, Mark, that she knew MLK, right? I mean, I heard a story that when he was down, he would sometimes call her on the phone and say, "Can you just sing me a song to kind of boost my spirits?" is that true?
Yeah, they're very close friends, and she early, especially during the Montgomery bus boycott. I mean, what's interesting about her political activism, and she was probably more explicitly active, partly because of the world she was in. I mean, so much of the civil rights movement kind of unfolded at Black churches. So those were spaces where she could contribute in different kinds of ways. But just the consistency and the range of ways, being involved in political campaigns, giving money to King's Southern Christian Leadership Conference, befriending him and supporting him when he went to, she was part of the Montgomery bus boycott and went down to sit in on nonviolent training sessions, all the way up to the March on Washington, but also in other ways too. She was an entrepreneur. She had several businesses, from a beauty shop to a flower shop to a fried chicken franchise. And so she really believed in Black self-help. So she supported King, but in some ways she shows the kind of fluidity of Black political philosophy, because she really had also admired the Nation of Islam, because they were very much about self-help. And so she was, I think, a politically practical or politically open kind of figure who saw no contradiction between supporting King and admiring the Nation of Islam.
Mm-hmm. And Carol, do you see parallels or contrasts with her role in the civil rights movement as compared with Marian Anderson's? And I know that your book seems to be, the book you're working on focuses on desegregation in classical music, and we're dealing with a different repertoire here, but how would you characterize the similarities and differences between their roles in trying to lift up other Black voices, move the ball forward in the civil rights era.
Well, they reached the peak of their careers, sort of the young peak of their careers, at a different moment in time. Yeah. So that makes a big difference. So for Mahalia Jackson, she's, you know, a major figure as the civil rights movement is really, you know, full steam ahead. Whereas for Marian Anderson, it's her career, especially the early part, is more part of what we now talk about as long civil rights movement. Those years of just kind of chipping away at Jim Crow indignities, little by little, but not really sustaining any kind of momentum. So that surrounding world, you know, made a big difference in terms of what they could do, how they could do it. I'm struck by what Mark said when he was introducing that recording and said that Jackson was so concerned about how she was represented. And that's a real parallel between both of them, and probably relates to their involvement in the civil rights movement in some ways. But both of them were very, very much in the public eye all of the time, and had a lot of, had handlers, had people who were mediating between them and the public, at the same time as, at least I can say with Anderson, she was in control of how she was viewed, where she was viewed, what she did. She was on top of it.
And it's interesting, back to your point, Mark, that Mahalia Jackson, I mean, I think the story that those of us like me who are not experts in Mahalia Jackson, the story that I know and what I believe to be the case is that she was not interested in singing music that was not gospel music. But it sounds like she was negotiating her image very carefully. She was kind of constructing her, for lack of a better term, her brand, her image, just as Marian Anderson was, that there was a lot of subtle maneuvering going on. And it's not as simple as saying that she just chose to do this or this, and precisely because she was a Black woman who had so many obstacles in her way. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, it's an interesting topic to think about, kind of Black musician and Black woman musician brand management, because I think it is the case. I mean, I think for Anderson, the reason why she didn't make statements was very much her brand was the quiet, dignified lady from Philadelphia. So she found other ways to kind of express that, even if it weren't a statement. Jackson, on the other hand, I think it's, I mean, this isn't a criticism of Jackson, but I do think that she, part of her brand was the woman who wouldn't sing secular music, even as she would compromise on occasion. So it became kind of part of why people appreciated her, that they were getting something that was kind of pure from the Black church, even though, you know, she'd sing Danny Boy here, or, you know, Victorian parlor songs there, or, you know, Beatles songs there. So it is really interesting how much work there was to negotiate the reception, not just of her, but of, you know, Black vernacular expression more broadly.
And it seems to me that's something that both of these figures can teach us today about the continual challenges for Black musicians to negotiate those kinds of things, how they're presented to the world, with whom they work, what kind of repertoire they choose, where they perform, et cetera. Which brings me to, I guess, a final question, a kind of broad question. You both have done such great work on these two figures. Carol, you're working on a book, and you've published widely on Marian Anderson. Mark, we didn't get a chance to talk about your two books. You just published a book called Mahalia Jackson and the Black Gospel Field, and then the Mahalia Jackson Reader, correct? Mm-hmm. So you're both very active in writing scholarship, helping other people to contribute their own ideas to discussing the legacies of these two figures. My question is, what more do we need? What more is needed to continue to shine a light on these two figures, to keep them from fading into obscurity potentially? And this is something that I know we discussed in a previous conversation, whether these figures are still enough in the public eye, in the public mind, and there's work required to keep them in the spotlight. What is needed in terms of scholarly work and other work going forward to keep these figures alive?
Well, I'll dive in to say, as with any great figures over the course of history, We need to keep examining and re-examining these two women over and over again. Times change, new sources come up, attitudes change, the ways we interpret materials change. And so, you know, for them to just stay in the forefront of scholarship and sort of the momentum of scholarship is important. Another really crucial trait has to do with education and with children learning about these two Black women, not just seeing a photo of them in a textbook, but hearing the performances, understanding what was involved in making those performances happen, grasping a sense of why we're at this really awful racial moment, that there's a long, ugly history to it. And there have been figures like Anderson and Jackson who've transcended the odds with beauty and dignity, but the history is still there and needs to be, ever new generations need to be reminded of it.
I will say that one small heartening sign is that my niece came home from school. She lives in Iowa where I grew up, and told my sister, who then told me, we were learning all about Marian Anderson in school. And I said, this is great. I'm going to talk to two people who write about Marian Anderson. So I was delighted to see that in a grade school setting, some of those things are happening, even though obviously there's more to do. Mark, how would you answer that question?
I mean, I think it's important to recognize, I mean, I talked about, you know, white reception of Mahalia Jackson and how she crossed over. But I think it's important to recognize that there is the extraordinary cultural political significance for African-Americans and Mahalia Jackson. And I think if you, I think a lot of white Americans may not have heard of her. If they know anything about gospel, maybe they know Mahalia Jackson, but you'd be hard pressed to find a Black household where someone does not know who Mahalia Jackson is. So in some ways, I think with Jackson, it's almost the reverse question of how do we assess and make sense of not her lack of recognition or kind of drifting into obscurity, but really her hypervisibility. What does it mean that we continue to tell her story over and over and over again? What are we returning to? What is each iteration shedding in some ways? Because I think that's the terms under which African Americans and Black music can be visible is as important as why it is occasionally invisible. So I think that's an important thing to remember. And I think also just that, I mean, the title of my book was Mahalia Jackson, the Black Gospel Field. It's also that, you know, there are a lot of Black gospel artists too. So I think the best way to honor and keep Mahalia Jackson alive is to tell more of the stories of the people that she was associated with, and making sure the archives, that oral histories are taken. There are people still walking the earth who perform with Mahalia Jackson. So I think the groundwork I think a rising tide will raise all gospel boats.
Well, I hope that those of you watching who love this music and enjoyed this conversation will read Mark's books, read Carol's and Mark's blog posts on the Women's Song Forum, read Carol's book when it's finished and it comes out, and continue to dig into this repertoire and share it with as many people as possible. Mark and Carol, thank you so much for the conversation. It was a real pleasure. I enjoyed learning more about your work and more about these two figures whom I knew about but didn't know enough about. And I'm really grateful that you took the time to talk to me.
Great. Thanks for inviting us.
Thanks so much.
Thank you everyone for watching. I appreciate you tuning in. Next week will be the final week where I'm guest hosting, and I'll be having a conversation with Larry Todd and Susan Wollenberg, and we'll be talking about women composers in the 19th century, and also the development of the study of women composers in the 20th and 21st century. Thank you everyone for watching.